If you have ever wandered through a forest or jungle and seen the variety of colors, species, and the beautiful diversity of life on Earth, you have obviously wondered how there can be so much beauty. We understand that species are fundamentally motivated by survival and reproduction, but that force on its own doesn't account for the extent of arbitrary but real beauty and symmetry. Nature is truly a work of art, but the reality of how this happens on the level of the species, organisms, the cosmos, and the reality of intelligence goes deeper than you might think. To understand how nature can be beautiful, we must start by seeing life through a cosmic perspective. The universe began 13.8 billion years ago as an explosion of completely disordered energy on a colossal magnitude. For the later part of the first billion years, this energy, in the form of particles by the help of gravity, was able to form around 100 billion galaxies, each with over 100 billion stars. One of these stars, our Sun, fortuitously formed from a gas cloud that contained a variety of heavy elements created in the hearth of a previous dead star. A mix of these elements formed the planets which we know today, including our own Earth. A few hundred million years after our Earth was able to cool from its smoldering formation, we can see liquid water as a result of our planet being the ideal distance from the Sun, not too hot, not too cold. About 13.7 billion years ago, something paramount happened in this water. For possibly the first time in the cosmos, at least to our knowledge, the law of entropy, which states that disorder always increases in the universe, was turned on its head. Due to our miraculous formation of organic molecules, then polymers, then protocells, and finally microbes, a new law of order was finally put in motion. This law would come to be known as Darwin's theory of evolution by natural selection. We all probably know the basic form of this theory. Within a species, there are organisms which can be born with mutations in their DNA. Most mutations are harmful or innocuous, but a rare few end up giving the organism a competitive advantage over its environment and others in its species. Given this advantage, the individual will be more fit to survive and reproduce. This trait will then continue to be passed on until it becomes the new rule in the species. One of the main ramifications of natural selection is that a species as a whole unit will become more fine-tuned and have specific, non-random features encoded into its collective genes. For example, as a means of escaping predators from above and below, the basilisk lizard has evolved large feet and a long tail. These features give the basilisk the ability to run on water for a period of time, which increases its ability to catch insects and not be caught by snakes and birds. Quite literally, due to its specific adaptation to living near water, the species fits well within the overall ecosystem and environment, and so it is deemed fit and it will survive and grow. This is all plain and clear as far as the logic of Darwin's theory goes, but this idea of fitness alone is not able to explain some of the ornaments found on species, such as the sight of a feather in a peacock's tail, which Darwin claimed makes me sick. This is an example where a different explanation for life's features must be provided. Darwin learned that this came as a result of something he called sexual selection. Sexual selection was not selection by the part of the environment like the basilisk. This was selection on the basis of the standard of beauty selected by the females in the species. This means that in a species where a large number of males compete and only few reproduce but rarely take part in the raising of the offspring, the females, somewhat as a whole, develop arbitrary standards for what is beautiful and hence attractive and judge the males on that basis. For example, in the case of the greater Lophornia, also known as the superb bird of paradise, it creates an absurd and near psychedelic appearing display in order to court a female. It postures up its secondary pitch black feathers in a way that also exposes the electric blue shape on its chest made to look like wings and eyes. He does a rapid dance hopping around the female in such a way that she only sees his frontal display and is almost mesmerized by this strange and beautiful electric void-like darkness. In this species, the females select the males based on how well their feathers and dance can match their perception of what is beautiful. This idea ran counter to the previous, more narrow explanation for selection. Alfred Wallace was a 19th century biologist who independently conceived evolution in the same year as Darwin and was a leading figure in the field. Wallace concluded that beauty in species served as a sign of health and was not selected by the females to meet their standard for the ornament itself. This idea was maintained for over a century as the common explanation because it was not seen as possible that animals could have a capacity for beauty, or that the conscious will of the females could have designed these extraordinary displays. As the neural network of the brain was better able to be mapped out, we were able to see a different view than what had been previously accepted. We now know that areas of the brain such as the anterior insula and the orbitofrontal cortex are widely associated with judging and perceiving beauty. The anterior insula is actually activated when we hear a beautiful piece of music or see art that we like. But the funny thing is, this area of the brain is also active in the appraisal of objects of evolutionary importance, such as the desirability of foods or the attractiveness of potential mates. This goes to show that beauty is not something that is separate from evolution, but instead, in the words of ornithologist Richard Prume, beauty is a co-evolved attraction, in which desire and the objects of desire have shaped one another. Building off of this gives a new framework for the way we can think about species. First off, we must understand that every species has its own subjective construction of reality, from mole rats feeling underground to bats using echolocation to fish in the deep dark and eagles with a bird's eye view. The ways different organisms view reality is dependent on their evolutionary history, their adaptations, and their environment. In this sense, species are unique in their standards of beauty, and so an ideal for a mate is constructed in the collective mind of the species. This ideal, like most in human society, turns out to be culturally malleable, even within a specific species. For example, we have observed in zebra finches that there is a sensory learning phase as a youth, in which a male finch will repeatedly hear the mating songs of the surrounding males. He will take these songs to heart and replicate them when trying to mate with a female, but the interesting thing is that this song is different in different regions, even within the zebra finch species. So a female in one area of a forest may try to find a mate which sings one specific song, whereas in another area just some miles over, that song would not be seen as attractive. This implies that in a very real sense, animals have a culturally learned and biased perception of what is beautiful and attractive. Now, taking all of what we learned about evolution together, from a cosmic perspective, to natural selection, to sexual selection, to neurological beauty, to cultural bias, we can think of a species or a subculture within a species as a holonic entity. Holonic in this way meaning something that is a whole in of itself while also being part of a larger whole. In this way, an organism within a species is comparable to a cell within an organism. It serves a part and purpose of a larger whole. In this view, the males in the species serve as genetic test dummies in which their variations are beneficial in creating possible innovation to the genetic code of the species. An example of this holonic ecological idea is mycelium. Mycelium is a network of fungal threads which is actually able to transmit electrical signals from 92% of all plant species. Trees can use this mycorrhizal network to transfer water, nutrients, and minerals to other trees, including their young, which they can recognize and support them by. This concept also goes beneath the ground and into the water. In the rivers, lakes, and oceans, we also see a beautiful variety of patterns, colors, and arrangements. Fish are more complex than land animals in their reasons for their beautiful, vibrant colors and artistic designs. For a species as a whole, it is advantageous to have a distinct pattern or color set, especially among diverse reefs, which allow them to distinguish members of their own species. Because of this, we can tell that the beauty perception and sexual selection plays an important role in the survival of the species as a whole. A beautiful ideal must be kept, idealized, and improved on in order to allow the species as a whole not to be beaten by another species, much in the same way one male is beaten by another male. But the concept of beauty does not only extend to visual ornaments, songs, and dances, but also to architecture. One phenomenal example of this is the pufferfish. The male pufferfish will use their fins and bodies to create large designs in the sand. When Japanese marine biologists first stumbled upon one of these designs, they assumed it must have been man-made based on the complexity, symmetry, and size of it. We now know that the males create these structures for the females to lay their eggs. Not only does the structure direct current away from the sediment in the center in order to protect the eggs, it also serves as a basis for judgment on the part of the females. In order for the males to be selected, they must have an idea of what the females are looking for, and then use their intelligence to create a specific, ordered, artistic display. The females can then tell by their creation whether a male is intelligent and skillful and has DNA that will serve the species well.
Certain physical displays also are architectured to allow the females to escape easily so a male cannot force himself on her, which further increases the accuracy of sexual selection.
As a whole, the selective process increases the ability of the females to judge for beauty and hence intelligence, and the ability of the males to recognize the ideal and replicate or creatively improve on it. Ultimately, the selective process increases perception. This brings us to the final piece of the puzzle of beauty, intelligence. Intelligence is the thing which allows the females in any species to select what is good, ideal, and beautiful. Intelligence is also what allows the males to try to reach this ideal. Males must have intelligence in order to perceive what the ideal is and then not only try to replicate it, but to creatively and intelligently refine it. Because beauty is arbitrary, it acts as a perfect evolutionary catalyst for intelligence. The arbitrariness of beauty forces there to be variations in different expressions of the organism's perception. Over eons, the selective pressure of the females and the expression and creativity of the males then pushes the species as a whole towards a more intelligent and beautiful existence. The grand realization from all of this is that in all life, perception is the basis for judgment, and for every judgment there is an ideal. In order for an ideal to survive, there must be individuals willing to test the limits of the ideal and refine it. This is only possible if intelligence is constantly improving and thinking of new ways to prove itself through expression. This then creates an infinite feedback loop in which perception, or consciousness, is used to select for intelligence, which therefore increases consciousness. Over and over, consciousness holonically increases itself through large systems of evolution in the universe. With enough time, consciousness can take the form of us, which can ask the question of how we, the cosmos, came to know itself. If you enjoyed this video and would like to see more videos focusing on important and unique ideals, please like, subscribe, and share. As always, never stop questioning, talking, and thinking. Thank you.